South Korea is well regarded as one of the world's top semiconductor manufacturing nations. They are a leader in the production of memory chips, they play a major role in foundry services, and they are expanding their influence in the logic chip market. But let's be real here. Their leadership and competitiveness in key semiconductor industries is fairly new. They weren't the leader in the 20th century and only emerged in the 21st. One of the leading nations that should have captured this industry is no other than the United States. As a leading innovative country, the US should have dominated the semiconductor manufacturing sector, leveraging its early advancements in microchip technology, research institutions, and a thriving ecosystem of tech companies. After all, the US pioneered the industry in the mid-20th century with companies like Fairchild Semiconductor, Intel, Texas Instruments, and IBM, laying the foundation for modern computing. But as many of you may know, the US isn't the leader in these critical industries. It is Taiwan for foundry services, but a share of that also belongs to South Korea. South Korea, however, even though it doesn't fully lead the foundry services, it leads in memory chips, which is a key market for the technology industry. So, why did South Korea beat the United States in this critical sector? Well, to understand this, let's first understand just how big of a lead South Korea has in these key industries. Let's first start with memory chips. Memory chips are basically a fundamental component of nearly every modern electronic device. They are divided into two main types: DRAM, dynamic random access memory, which is used for temporary data storage in computers and smartphones, and NAND flash, which is used for long-term storage in devices like SSDs, USB drives, and memory cards. South Korea dominates both of these markets. Two of the world's largest memory chip manufacturers, Samsung Electronics and SK Hynix, are based in South Korea. Here's a graph on the NAND flash market share by company. Here you can see that there are two Korean companies that dominate the list, which, as we just mentioned, are Samsung and SK Hynix. The American company that has a significant market share is Micron, but compared to what the two Korean companies hold, it is small in comparison. Likewise, if we were to take a look at the market share in DRAM, we get to see that both of these Korean companies are again at a lead. Only Micron, which holds a 22.2% share, is the only significant American company. But the company is still overshadowed by the Korean companies. On foundry services, in case you're not aware of what this is, it is basically contract manufacturing for semiconductors. Foundries produce chips for companies that design but do not manufacture their own semiconductors. These companies, known as fabless chip makers, include industry giants like Apple, Nvidia, Qualcomm, and AMD. The foundry business is crucial because most tech firms today outsource chip production rather than building expensive fabrication plants, fabs, themselves. Here's a graph on the market share of each company. Here, you can see that Taiwan's TSMC leads the world. But second on the list is Samsung, a Korean company. Likewise, you can see that American companies don't really have a big market share in this list. That's because the United States has largely lost its dominance in semiconductor manufacturing over the past few decades. While American companies like Intel were once the leaders in chip fabrication, they have fallen behind due to multiple strategic and structural failures. Instead, Taiwan and South Korea now control the foundry industry, leaving the US dependent on Asian manufacturers for advanced semiconductor production. But you'd probably be lost if you were to graph out the largest semiconductor companies by market cap. If we were to do that, we would see that some of the largest semiconductor companies by market cap aren't actually Asian companies, but instead we get Nvidia, Broadcom, Texas Instruments, and so on. So, aren't these leaders in semiconductors? Well, the answer is yes, but not in manufacturing. Many of the largest semiconductor companies by market capitalization are American, but they are primarily focused on chip design rather than fabrication. Now that we have an understanding of how South Korea leads in key semiconductor manufacturing sectors, let's understand how South Korea got here. There's one big reason for South Korea's semiconductor rise, and that's no other than the country's industrial policy and support. South Korea's government has played an active role in nurturing its semiconductor industry. As early as 1969, the government passed the Electronics Industry Promotion Act, offering subsidies and incentives to encourage domestic electronics and chip production. Semiconductors were identified as a strategic industry for export, alongside heavy and chemical industries in the 1970s. The government provided tax breaks, low-interest loans, and infrastructure support to chaebol conglomerates like Samsung and Hyundai, later SK Hynix, to enter the semiconductor field. For example, in the late 1960s and 1970s, South Korea used joint ventures with foreign firms, e.g. Samsung's early partnerships with Sanyo and NEC, to acquire know-how while shielding its market. Imports of Japanese electronics were restricted unless produced locally via joint venture. This combination of protection and knowledge transfer helped build an indigenous capability. In the 1980s and 1990s, South Korean authorities continued to back the chip sector as part of national technology programs. They offered generous financing and bailouts during downturns to ensure the industry's survival. Notably, after the 1997 Asian financial crisis, the government temporarily nationalized banks and pressured state-controlled banks to bail out Hynix, formerly Hyundai Electronics, when it was on the verge of collapse. By 2001, over 90% of new loans in a Hynix rescue package came from banks where the Korean government was the largest shareholder. Here's a list of the financial support packages for Hynix in 2001 and 2002. Here, you can see that Hynix didn't just receive millions, but billions and billions of dollars. This isn't something that really occurs in the United States, because the US follows a more market-driven approach to business, where companies are expected to survive based on their own financial performance. Unlike South Korea's government-led industrial policies, the US has historically been reluctant to directly bail out tech companies, unless there is a broader national security or financial stability concern. But while these measures were considered controversial by some, they eventually kept Hynix afloat and allowed consolidation. These interventions meant South Korea retained two major memory chip producers when other countries' firms were failing. Here's a graph to depict the setbacks seen in those years. Here what you see are the major world DRAM producers. You can see that there was a significant decrease from 2000 to 2001. At the same time, you could also see the Japanese companies. These were entities that actually used to hold a larger share in the global DRAM manufacturing business, but fell off to competition against the Korean companies. And even though these government-led industrial policies were in the past, we are still seeing, even until this very day, how the Korean government has prioritized and promoted this key industry. South Korea had announced a $19 billion package of incentives for semiconductors and plans to build the world's largest semiconductor manufacturing cluster by 2047 with $470 billion in investments. Now, when we contrast the United States semiconductor industry, we get to see that they had a hands-off approach. The US led the semiconductor revolution in the 1960s and 1970s. By the early 1970s, US firms held around 60% of the world chip market. But this was driven largely by private companies, like Intel, Texas Instruments, and defense-related R&D funding, rather than direct industrial policy. The US did respond when its dominance eroded in the 1980s. Facing fierce competition from Japanese firms, Washington negotiated the 1986 US-Japan Semiconductor Agreement to counter what it saw as unfair trade practices. This accord pressured Japan to raise memory chip prices and guarantee US firms a share of the Japanese market. However, beyond such trade measures and the formation of Semitech, a public-private R&D consortium in 1987, the US government provided relatively limited direct subsidies or protection to its semiconductor manufacturers in the late 20th century. American policy emphasized free markets, which benefited consumers with low prices, but meant US memory chip makers had to survive on their own. Indeed, most US DRAM makers, except Micron, exited the business by the 1990s. Only recently, in response to Asian competition and supply chain concerns, has the US pivoted to industrial support with the 2022 CHIPS Act, which allocates around $52 billion in subsidies for domestic semiconductor manufacturing. Now, of course, there are more reasons out there beyond government intervention that helped push South Korean firms to capture this industry. It could include the strategy where companies like Samsung would invest massively into manufacturing capacity and research and development. As a matter of fact, Samsung is well known to outspend many major American companies for innovation. There's a lot more reasons, but government intervention and policies are arguably one of the major reasons. But anyway, do let us know what you think. Thanks for watching.